Good morning. It's Monday as we begin a new week and continue our series looking at the remainder of the Beatitudes. Let me pray. Let's pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, as we begin this new working week, we pray that you'd help us to pause, to stop before we fill our minds with the busyness of all that the day and the week holds. Help us to listen to your voice, to listen to the words of the Lord Jesus this morning. Give us ears to hear what he has to say to us. And we ask it in his precious name. Amen. Amen. Well, do open Matthew chapter 5 and I'll read the Beatitudes. Matthew chapter 5 from verse 3. Jesus said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Well, do keep that open. I've described the Beatitudes as an anatomy of repentance. And I don't know how you found biology at school. I have vivid memories of dissecting a sheep eye and also a sheep's digestive system. Sorry if this is a bit graphic as you eat your breakfast this morning. But under the direction of a good teacher, you can discover how something works, the inside of something, how the whole thing fits together and what each part plays. And that's what we're doing as we unpack these Beatitudes. Jesus is showing us what repentance looks like on the inside, what the entry qualification is for those who will be part of his kingdom. And we've seen that they will be poor in spirit. That is, they'll recognise that they don't have the resources in order to stand before God on their own. They will mourn. As we look inside ourselves, we see our sin and it grieves us. It causes us to weep. And they'll be meek. There'll be those who know that they don't have a leg to stand on. They've got no defence, and so they won't defend themselves. And today, verse 6, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." The essence of this beatitude is the longing to be godly. I don't know if you remember that feeling as a child of wanting to please your parents. Our children, I'm sure all children, I was like this when I was a child, loved to annoy their parents. But also in their better moments, there is a good and a right feeling of wanting to please our parents. Isla, when I'm working, will sort of pop little notes under the door, just practicing her joined up handwriting. You won't be able to see them. But, you know, it's not that we're wanting to earn anything or for desire, and not a desire for payment or what I will get out of it. No, it's simply this, and this is what Jesus is describing here in this verse. It is that desire to please my Heavenly Father. That's what this desire and longing for godliness is about in this verse. Not out of payment, not for what I'll get out of it, but because I love him. And I want to make him look at me with pleasure. And that's part of, Jesus is saying here, part of what repentance is about. A turning from sin to God. And this beatitude here ends the first half of the Beatitudes. And it prepares us for what's to come. In a sense, verse 6 is a bit like a hinge verse. Up until now, we've been focusing on our poverty, or on what it is that we're turning from. And the next three Beatitudes will be focused on what we're turning to. Repentance is turning from God to God, from sin to Christ. And the first three have been about our poverty. The next three will be about what we're turning to, building up to the conclusion of verse 10 about persecution. And verse 6 is a hinge verse. And it captures both our poverty, what we're turning from, and our desire to turn to something better. And I love that Jesus has included this. This, I was thinking about which is my favourite beatitude. This may be it. I may disagree with that in a couple of days' time. But I'm so grateful that it's included here. Note what he says. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. This is not about having achieved righteousness. If Jesus was describing people who were already righteous, he wouldn't say that they were hungry and thirsty for it. There is a poverty in this verse. This isn't that feeling you get after Christmas dinner where you're sitting back stuffed and content. No, it's the end of a hard day's work feeling desperately hungry. It's not righteousness achieved, but neither is it righteousness abandoned. Perhaps you know what that feels like too, the sense that I'm never going to make it anyway, so why should I bother? God loves me, so I've got no need to worry about pleasing him. But that's not right. It's not righteousness abandoned or righteousness achieved. It's righteousness adored, valuing it highly, but knowing that you don't yet have it. Hungering and thirsting for it, adoring it and longing for it. What a precious balance this verse strikes. Maybe if you're thinking to yourself, actually, do you know what? I don't always desire to be godly. I don't hunger and thirst for righteousness, as Jesus describes here. Well, that is a warning signal in our lives. If you go in for to have a CT scan or an MRI scan or something to kind of examine your heart, then that might be a warning signal for us. You see, that righteousness achieved has no place in Jesus' kingdom. We enter by confessing our poverty and not sitting back and thinking that we've already made it. A righteousness abandoned has no place either. Part of repentance is to hunger and thirst for godliness, to be like the Lord Jesus. We are often more shaped by what the world loves than what Jesus loves. And how are we to grow then, to love what Jesus loves? How are we to grow in godliness? Well, what God loves is revealed in his law. God's law is a beautiful thing. I think about Matt's sermon yesterday where Jesus summed up the law, the greatest commandment, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind and strength, and your neighbour as yourself. Do you see how good that is? Let that whet your appetite. When we thought about mourning last week, I said that God's law will help us to mourn. It will do that. But it also shows us what righteousness looks like so that we will adore it. As we see God's law, we come away thinking, I would love to be able to enjoy Sabbath rest filled with worship and praise. I would love to be part of a family and a society where those in authority are honoured and worthy of honour. I would love to be pure and not coveting what others have. I would love for God to be first in my heart above all else so that I'd worship him truly. I would love that, but I recognise that it's something I hunger and thirst for because I don't have it yet. Now, this verse 6, is not a lament that we're not like this. The longing itself is a good one. It is a blessed thing. Because it's a bit like heading home, starving, but knowing that when we get there, there is a wonderful meal waiting on the table for us. Life in Jesus' kingdom is blessed because we know that there is a day coming when our hunger and our thirst will be fully satisfied. When we'll be made like the Lord Jesus, because we will see him as he is. This is part of repentance, true repentance, and a wonderful comfort to Christians who struggle with sin, who want to love his laws but fail and can't find the self-discipline within ourselves. These words are a tremendous comfort. I'm going to close with the prayer that I prayed last week as well, because I feel it fits very well here. Let me pray this. Almighty God, You alone can order the unruly wills and passions of sinful men and women. Grant that your people may love what you command and desire what you promise, so that among the many and varied changes of this world, our hearts may be firmly fixed where true joys are to be found, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.